Hi, I'm Bill Griffith, an application engineer with Agilent Technologies. Today we're going to talk about making accurate thermocouple measurements. In a previous video, we talked about how a thermocouple works. And today I thought it'd be interesting to start at the tip of the thermocouple and look at the different error mechanisms in a thermocouple measurement all the way back to our data logger. So let's start at the tip with the three thermal errors. The first is adhesion. You want to make sure that your thermocouple is well adhered to the device that you're measuring, because if it pops up or lifts up, you're going to be measuring the air temperature above the device. The next one is you want to consider the mass of the sensor compared to the mass of the device you're measuring. I have an insulated thermocouple, and it has a large metal tube on it, so it has a lot of mass. So this would be very appropriate for measuring a small semiconductor device. These insulated thermocouples, you also need to take into account that it's going to take a while for the thermal energy to go through the insulation and actually warm up the thermocouple. So leaving some extra time in your measurement to make sure that it has warmed up is important. They do make them where the actual metal tube is connected to the thermocouple, and that will increase the speed at which the thermal energy gets to the thermocouple. Let's move on to some electrical considerations. The first electrical consideration is our typical thermocouple. It is a bare wire connection, and so if you're connecting to a metal motor or cabinet, it is a perfect path for ground loops. And so you want to pick an instrument to measure with that has good common mode rejection to avoid those ground loops. The other option is to use one of the insulated type thermocouples. When measuring a thermocouple, it creates a very small voltage based on the temperature gradient across it. And so noise will be an issue. So it's important to use short wires to avoid picking up as much noise as possible. The other thing you can do is most measurement instruments have a way of trading speed off for accuracy. So the idea is to always pick a slower measurement, make one good measurement instead of lots of fast measurements to reject that noise. Okay, moving on, the next source of error would be our thermal connect up to our reference junction. And so you want to pick a good reference junction because it's going to provide the absolute temperature. After the reference junction, our next source of errors will be the algorithm inside of our data logger. And so the algorithm actually has to remove the errors produced when we connect our thermocouple up to our reference junction. We actually create two more dissimilar metal junctions. We've got to back that out. And then the algorithm has to convert the voltage to a temperature. And so how well it does it is the accuracy of that algorithm. So to give you a real life example, on our 34970 and our 34972, it actually specifies 1 degree of accuracy for a J-type thermocouple from the reference junction to the display. So if our thermocouple has about a degree of accuracy, that means our system error is going to be 2 degrees C. So there are certainly more accurate sensors than a thermocouple, but thermocouples are really known for their ruggedness and their large temperature range that they can measure across. So in measuring thermocouples, the things you want to keep in mind, again, are those thermal accuracies. Make sure you have good adhesion. And then noise will be an issue with thermocouples because it's such a small voltage. So make sure your wires are short and that you make one good reading instead of many fast readings. I hope this is helpful. Thanks for watching.